I'll just take a minute to introduce Nigel to everyone. So I'm sure most of you have attended a training by Nigel. They're always very entertaining and hugely valuable. I know for myself, I first attended one of his trainings back in 2007, and I've heard you speak many times since then, Nigel. So every time I do hear you speak, I do learn something new. So most of you will also know that Nigel owns his own company called Agile Bear. He works in that company as an Agile coach and a consultant and a certified Scrum trainer. I think you're certified since 2007. I believe I was maybe one of your earlier kind of people that you trained. Yeah, you experimented on me maybe. But from my own personal point of view, I would highly recommend you with any of those activities. I know you're very interested in using Scrum in distributed teams at an enterprise scale. And I know you've presented many times at Scrum gatherings across the EU and the US. It reminds me of a very interesting evening that we actually had in Barcelona one time at one of those Scrum gatherings. I'm not sure how much of that you remember. But anyway, with that said, I'm really looking forward to your talk on how Agile practices evolve over time. You're very welcome. And thank you, Nigel.
Thank you, Fitz. What a lovely leading. Thank you so much, Fitz. That's very good. Good morning, everyone. Or is it now good afternoon? Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for sacrificing what is effectively your lunch hours to come and hear me speak. The title of this presentation has changed a few times. Dee, can I get the rights to share screen, please? So I can sort of show people. Ah, there we go. Could you get the right? There we go. Thank you so much. Here we go. Here we go. So the title's changed. It started out as like how agile practices evolved over time. And then I realized the horrible fact that pretty much next week is the 20th anniversary of Agile. So I thought, well, I've got to mention that. And then I thought, how do I mention that? And I realized what this entire conversation is going to be about is about context is king. Okay. And how that can positively affect us, how that can negatively affect us, and how that sort of context and evolution is going to be really important for us in what I would call the next 20 years of Agile, basically, in the 21st century Agile, next 20 years of Agile. So where I want to start us is basically me. Who doesn't know me, brother? Show of hands if you don't know me. Anyone not know me out there? God, there's a lot of people who know me. Anyone show of hands? There we go. Oh, basically, as Vince said, I'm a certified Scrum trainer. I've been teaching, advocating, using Scrum for nearly 20 years now, over 18 years. I was one of the first Agile coaches on the planet, people actually who come and help you do Scrum, and been a trainer in this for about, 17 odd years. Let's go back in time. Let's go back in time, right? Where are we going to? A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. So February the 11th to the 13th, 2001. 20 years ago, pretty much, what's that, next week? 20 years ago, maybe the week after next, was that famous meeting where 17 software development experts came together to discuss tools and techniques. Famously called, they produced the world-famous Agile Manifesto, and in fact, they even came up with the term Agile. So I want to explain a little bit about this, though. So here's the funny thing. Everyone talks about the Agile Manifesto. Okay. A quick show of hands. Who's seen the Agile Manifesto before? Show of hands, seen the Agile Manifesto. It's like the most famous foundational document on which Agile is built. If you haven't seen it, can I do it from the top of my head? Let me think. It says, let's see if I can do this. We are uncovering better ways of developing software by doing it and by helping others to do it. Through that work, we've come to value individuals and interactions over processes and tools. We've come to value, what's the next line? We've come to value responding to change over following a plan. We've come to value, could you do the other two? We've come to value, what else have we come to value? Can you remember the other two? What are the other two? The individuals and interactions over processes and tools. Responding to change over following a plan.
Documentation.
Yeah, working results over comprehensive documentation and customer collaboration over contract negotiation, right? So that was like the fundamental piece. What they were basically saying is people-centric, change-centric, customer-centric, and result-centric is what they're saying, focusing on these things, right? But this didn't appear magically overnight at that meeting. There have been people using these ideas for many years beforehand, sort of a good 5, 6, 7 years beforehand. There was various flavors of what they call lightweight methods. Okay, that was their name, the lightweight methods. And so they sort of had these various flavors, and they were all concerned, basically, that there were some very popular heavyweight methods out there, methods that were thick and heavy and almost algorithmic. You know, like, hey, follow this rule book, you will get success. And they all knew that rule book was wrong, but they didn't all necessarily agree on what was right. And so they had all these different flavors, flavors of agility, these flavors, these ideas. And they all came together to basically come to some common agreement on what they all stood on, common principles. I was reading the other day about, and this is a really weird thing to mention in terms of agile, but it was about like the dawn of man. And I don't know if you know this, and again, I'm not an expert in this, so feel free to treat it with the contempt it deserves. But it was kind of saying that this traditional model we've had of mankind evolving isn't really like that. There was actually loads of different flavors of mankind. There's loads of different styles, loads of different models of mankind, and gradually one won through. Now, how it won through, I haven't got to that part of the book yet. But I could easily imagine that not being the most friendly and warm way of becoming the chief flavor of mankind. Okay, what's that got to do with here? Well, back in 2001, the most popular agile technique was something called extreme programming. Okay, it came out a couple of years before and was getting a lot of traction. People were quite excited by it. It was so exciting, Microsoft allegedly stole its name for their operating system, Windows XP. And so took the name of extreme programming and used it to give their sort of, hey, my cool new, look at the cool new Windows. Ooh, we're cool. Yeah, we ride skateboards. We're extreme. Anyway, that's what was popular in 2001. What actually became the most popular flavor of Scrum? Scrum? Agile. I gave it away. It's Scrum, right? So what happened was actually after that meeting, the Scrum became by far the most popular approach. Why? Well, it's quite interesting because what actually happened with Scrum in 2001, it was almost unheard of. It was one of the minor flavors of agility. It was the parent of some of the others, but it was very minor. And what actually happened was a gentleman called Ken Schwaber, a business consultant, put on his business hat and thought, okay, how can we popularize this? And what he did was, he was the man who very famously invented the certifications, Certified Scrum Master. Who here has done Certified Scrum Master training with me? With me, who's done Certified Scrum training? Who's done it with someone else? I don't blame you. It's not quite as good as with me, but who would like to do Certified Scrum training with Nigel in the future? Just want to check on that one. Yeah, all of you, of course, thank you. Ken was the man who invented certification in the agile space. Now, a lot of people didn't like that. They didn't like the idea of, hey, these badges, these certificates. But the facts remain, by coming up with a model of licensing and certification of quality controlling, both training and trainer, people like me, what they discovered very rapidly was this was very attractive to business and very attractive to people. And so rapidly, the amount of people using Scrum shot up. So you can see here, between 2002, there was effectively no one using Scrum, okay? I started doing it in 2003. I got certified around 2005. I was member 2025 of the Scrum Alliance. Now, the only reason I know that is because that's my user ID in the Scrum Alliance, basically. It just used to have like literally just a number going up, 1, 2, 3. So 2025. It has exploded. It exploded, became very, very popular, right? So we're suddenly in this huge growth phase, right? Agile's getting really cool. Specifically Scrum is getting really exciting. People are really getting into it, exponential year on year. Now, this was a problem for Ken, because there's only so many people Ken could train, okay? So Ken came up with, right at the start, this idea of certifying trainers, getting people who have skill to work with you, to teach this stuff, so it doesn't have to be him, right? In a non-profit, so he doesn't get the cash, he goes back into the community, okay? Getting people to do it. But again, so if you think about it, Agile was almost like a startup at the start. It was bootstrapping itself, exponential growth, found its market fit with the certification thing, and then gradually we've got to try to expand into that market. And so the Alliance tried to come up with loads of different ways of judging trainers. So at the very start, you can imagine you're running a startup and it's just you. How do you find a colleague to work with you? You tap a friend on the shoulder and say, hey, mate, could you come help me out with my startup? You know, just me and you together, dude. That's what Ken did at the start, is people he knew. And then he started trying to mentor people. Hey, I'll be your Jedi master and you be the Padawan learner. I try and mentor people up. But again, it doesn't scale, does it? As a startup, you need to think about how you're going to reach volume. And so what happened was at the time, they started trying to invent methods to add people who could teach this stuff, add people of skill. Now, at the start, they basically put together a process that was so difficult, only 3 people on Earth passed it in 1 year, right? And I was one of them, hey! But it was too hard, right? And so the year later, Ken said, okay, we've got to get some more people training this. We've got to get some more people out there. And so what he did was he got a list of people and they went through them and said, that person knows what they're talking about. That person doesn't know what they're talking about. Now, whether you think that's a good approach or not, that is a possibly a legitimate strategy to bootstrap the growth of your startup. But those people being judged on a thumbs up or thumbs down, that's not a high quality bar, is it? And so we had some problems, okay? So in 2009, if you think about it, the Agile thing's been going for 8 years now and Scrum has really taken off. It's really become the main thing, the main push, the main value add, right? And we're having some problems. So August 2009, us trainers, there's about 100 of us at this point, right? We're discussing Agile on our training forum. Now, this forum is notoriously where we bicker with each other over Agile minutiae that none of you would care anything about at all, right? But we're sat there going, well, I think you'll find... like really nerdly with each other. Anyway, we were discussing Agile project managers. And as you can imagine in a discussion, it rapidly went into release planning, went into project management, it went all over the place, right? Now, why would I tell you about this discussion? Well, the context of this discussion was crucial. Because at this point in the Alliance, there's a lot of variation going on, right? So we have some issues. So Scrum itself is still quite malleable. Right? It's still evolving, it's still growing, it's still quite new, right? And so everyone has like a slightly different interpretation of what it is. So Ken Schwaber came up with this Scrum guide. Has anyone ever seen the Scrum guide at all? It's this sort of like this specification of Scrum. Yeah, it's not exactly the most exciting read on earth. And but Ken was trying to come up with, we wanted him to come up with a hub of information, like a rich source of data. He came up with like a 7-page document. But anyway, this like definition of Scrum. Also, what should we be teaching you in that Scrum course? Because that's actually quite interesting, because a lot of things we need to teach you to be a good Scrum master aren't actually Scrum things. They're things like listening skills and servant leadership. These aren't an agile technique. Servant leadership has been around 50 years. And finally, we want to try and examine you. So we were at the time trying to develop an examination to try and validate your knowledge. It's all well and good calling this stuff certified, but without any form of validation or test, can you really get away with calling it that? Probably not, right? And so there's this combination of these 4 contexts all rubbing each other up the wrong way. One, the trainers don't really know if the others are reliable or not. Like, do you know what you're talking about or not, right? This guide has come up. Does that really capture what Scrum is? Or is it this exam has come up? And this course has come up, the training course, and these are all clashing horribly, right? But diversity gives new thoughts. And so in this discussion, I came up with a new idea. I said, okay, we seem to be having a lot of problems in the Alliance, basically understanding what we're talking about and why we're talking about it. Like, what should be in the course? That's different to what is Scrum, you know, and what should be in the exam? That's different to what is Scrum. And so I invented the world famous Nigel scale, right? Now, I will tell you why it's called the Nigel scale. I literally discovered why the other day, reading back through the old posts. I thought I was mocking myself. So for years, I've told people I called it the Nigel scale because I was being a bit egotistical for a bit of a joke. That isn't actually what happened, right? About 15 years ago, there was something in the industry called the Nokia test. Has anyone ever heard of that? The Nokia test. Good. It died off, thank God. But what happened was some compatriots of mine working for Nokia Networks in, I think it was in Europe, continental Europe somewhere, they came up with a spreadsheet that was effectively a way of judging your agileness. We're not going to comment on whether that's a good idea or a bad idea. It's a bad idea. But what I would say is I came up with the Nigel scale as a slight riff on the Nokia test. Now, I know what you're waiting for. What is the Nigel scale? It's a very simple model to help us understand agility a bit deeper. It's 3 points, right? Point number one is there is what I would call core, Nigel scale one. There are things, I used to call it Scrum, but there are things that are fundamental to what we do. Fundamentals that if you bend them, everything breaks, right? I'll give an example in real life. Surgeons. Surgeons disinfect their hands. They wash their hands. That is not an option in surgery. You know, your surgeon doesn't have the right to say, do you know what? I don't believe in bacteria. I don't think it exists. Thus, I'm not going to wash my hands. Shut up. Wash your bloody hands. Or, do you know what? I believe in bacteria, but actually, it's good for you. I believe that bacteria is good for your digestive transit. And so I'm going to dip my hands in cow manure so that I get those good bacteria on it. And then I can remove your spleen. Shut up. Shut up, shut up, shut up. You can have your own opinions, that's fine, but you can't have your own facts. That's not how facts work, okay? There are certain things that if you bend them, things go, and that stuff we need to be incredibly disciplined on, right? Now, unfortunately, in life, most of what we do in Agile isn't that. It's this. Nigel scale two, stuff that Scrum doesn't care about. This is the weird and wonderful world of good practice, okay? This is where, hey, do you know what? I've got a thing, and this thing works really well for me. Maybe it'll work really well for you. The key word in that phrase is may. Just because it works for me doesn't mean it's guaranteed to work for you. It may do, but may is doing a lot of heavy lifting there. And this is where you've got to be very careful in an agile approach, right? You've really got to use your prior experience, understand your context, to sort of coach organizations to find their own answers to their own complex problems, right? This is a world of adaptability, flexibility, not one size fits all. Who would say they're doing Scrum at the moment? Not at this exact moment, you're on a call, but who would say they're doing Scrum in work? Show of hands, Scrummers. Show of hands, people doing a bit of Scrum. There we go. So basically, in Scrum, there are loads of things that aren't. So things like user stories. You ever heard of user stories, requirement technique? Not Scrum, right? Velocity, a way of measuring performance. Not Scrum. Story points, a way of estimating. Not Scrum. Release planning, standing up every day in your daily stand-up. Not Scrum. These are all practices that are good. They're good. They're good practices. They're lovely, right? I like them. Just because I like them doesn't mean they are some sort of universal panacea. Right? They may be right for you. There's a good chance they'll be good for you, but good does not equal best. In the world of complex work, which is where we live, there are very, very, very few best practices. There are quite a few good ones, but there are very few best ones. And then finally, we come to Nigel scale three, which is bad. Bad, bad stuff, stuff you should avoid, anti-patterns, things that people have tried year on year and they don't work. Now, as I just said, never say never. Maybe you'll be the company that makes that technique work. Maybe. But there's a big pile of bodies out back of companies who thought they could make that technique work. Yeah, you're not a special flower. You're not a unique. There's lots of people who have tried that and died trying that. I would like you to be afraid of those ones. Be step very carefully around them. And the point I was trying to make all those years ago was basically people seem to be confusing the three. They seem to be confusing bad practice with a good practice. Hey, here's something that's really dodgy, but maybe we could do it. Like, and confusing core practices with good practices. Oh, that's kind of optional, you know. So like self-organization is a fundamental agile thing. Teams are empowered to organize themselves. It's not an optional thing. It's not like, oh, I love the agile thing, except the team's having brains. I don't want that bit. Everything else is lovely, but the team's thinking, don't want that. That's not right. And this was a problem 10 to 15 years ago. People basically confusing where they should have discipline with where they should have flexibility, okay? 10 years forward, 15 years forward, people are still making the same blooming mistake, right? They're still making the same mistake, which is they are confusing what is core with what is good, and what is good is what is bad. Quiz time. Ready for a quiz, right? It's quiz time now. You're not just going to sit there and watch me talk. That's not good enough. I would like you to go to the chat box now. Please go to the chat box, and I'm going to ask you three questions, okay, in the chat box. I'm going to ask you, first things first, I want you to tell me core, Nigel scale one things, things you feel are absolutely fundamental to the heart to delivering complex work. Choose now, type in the box now, tell me things you think are fundamental hygiene things, like brushing your teeth, you know, like having a shower every day, stuff that is really fundamental, right? Really, coffee, oh my God, definitely straight in there. Jump in. Oh yeah, that's quite interesting. Teamwork, very much. Teamwork makes the dream work. Diet Coke, thank you, Paul. You know exactly that's what's needed. Retrospectives, yeah, inspecting, right? Inspecting and adapting. Like a fundamental thing. If you don't inspect and adapt, that we always say, if you just inspect without making improvements, you're a masochist, right? You just look at bad things and don't improve them. If you adapt without inspecting, you're chaotic. You're just changing things semi-randomly, okay? Yeah, reflection, so, so important. Trust, listening to the trust. Trust comes up again and again and again. So for me, this Nigel scale one is really things that are like values, principles, and what I would call the fundamental patterns behind Scrum, like reflection, you know, self-organization, incrementalism. Right? These are fundamentals. Okay, right now, that's enough now. Thank you so much. That's enough now. Right, let's now go to Nigel scale two. But what's good stuff? What is, send it to everyone. What's the Nigel scale two thing? Things that are good. Things, oh, that's a good thing. That's a nice thing. Let's talk about some Nigel scale two things. All things could be good. Good practices may not work for everyone, but could work for you. Standards, quite interesting. Yeah, story points. Yeah, exactly. I gave some of these away, by the way, I just realized a moment ago. But hey, that's a good practice, isn't it? Just use the information you've just learned. Acceptance criteria. Estimation. Yeah, interesting. Yeah, estimation is not compulsory. Swarming. Yeah, we're getting more people on the same thing. Pair programming. Yeah. So these are all sort of good, lovely fillings of the sandwich. It doesn't have to be the same filling in every sandwich, okay? Now, I'm going to ask, give me some... Now, bearing in mind, I'm definitely putting a time limit on the next question because this could go on and on and on. Give me some bad stuff. Give me some bad mojo, some bad practices. We could... Yes, thank you, sharks related. That's not even the worst thing I've seen, Aidan, to be honest, mate. Give me some bad stuff, egos, project management. Don't love the sin, love the sinner, hate the sin. So project managers aren't evil. They're wonderful human beings. Some of them, I've been a project manager. I think the act of a central coordinator is dangerous, but that person can be really, really powerful. Yeah, unplanned work, just flying in, micromanagement, ouch. Comparing teams, super ouch. Comparing teams is enough. Who here has siblings? Anyone got siblings, brothers and sisters? Did your parents ever compare you to your siblings? If they did, how did it make you feel? Exactly, it's something you should learn when you're a child, isn't it? Don't compare me to Mike. Not that I'm bitter. Poor leadership. Oh, trying to plan everything in advance. Yeah, stop it now. Whoa, time, we've got enough of the bad stuff. But you can see, and I think I've got a picture to show it. Let me show you. Yeah, basically, there is an absolute ocean of bad practice out there, okay? In that ocean, it's a little island of good practice. And on top of that island of good practice is a tiny sliver of core stuff, okay? What I would suggest is a good Scrum, good Agile, is actually about being incredibly disciplined about the top and the bottom. being very disciplined about those core fundamental things, incredibly ruthless about those bad practices, and the stuff in between the two, being open-minded, being flexible, being agile, as in adaptable, being agile in terms of as changeable. I think that's a good way to look at this sort of stuff. And what we're seeing a lot in industry is people either accepting the bad and just having a horrible life, or they're being overly strict on the middle, right? And you end up almost with like a cult, or like a sort of a ritualized approach, taking things that may be good for someone else and is bad for you. Okay, so that's the idea. That's the idea. Now, that is not my only invention in life. As Vince said, I've been doing hundreds of presentations over the years, talking at conferences and keynoting and all this. But what I've just pulled out here is sort of six things, just the steel thread of the Nigel scale and how it's developed over the years. So it isn't just like, what I did back in 2009 was categorization, bad, core, good. A lot of the work I've done since then is expanding on that. So back in 2013 and 14, I basically interviewed hundreds of people about how they feel about Agile. Not what I feel, how they generally feel about it, right? In 2016, I tried to deep dive those good practices in possibly the most boring conference presentation ever given by a human being on this planet, right? It was so boring, I put a health warning on it at the start. You can see at the bottom there, it was so dull, halfway through the presentation, I got bored, right? That's pretty impressive when you're boring yourself in your own presentation. It was dry as ditch water. What I realized was that world of good practice is a hell of a big world, right? It's a hell of a big space. But the two fundamental things that have changed really how I approach this is one about uncertainty. Okay, the big thing I learned in the world, I did this presentation on uncertainty. And when I started writing the presentation, what I was trying to communicate was uncertainty in content. The idea in Agile, through the act of creation, you discover more. Right? The idea of Agile at the start of a project, you know the least about a project you'll ever know. Okay, that's what I was trying to communicate, this idea of change, not vagueness. Uncertainty doesn't mean you don't know where you're going, it means it could change. But through the act of creation, you discover more. As I started creating that presentation, I realized the most interesting thing for us as agile people is not changing content in your projects or products. It's the uncertainty of process, how process can change. Okay. And that's when I got into time. I did this presentation based on Doctor Who a couple of years ago, and that got me to the understanding that, hang on a minute, we talk about these practices, they're good or they're bad or they're core, but that changes over time. Practices decay like milk. Some practices age like a fine wine and become valid over time. And I think that is not a conversation that anyone is actually having properly in the world of Agile. You'll get a lot of people saying, that is bad, that is good, that is core. And actually what they need to be thinking about is the flow, the journey, right? And that takes me to basically, context is king, takes me to the last presentation I did in public when I said, we should start visualizing this. What we said, okay, practices change over time, that's great, but could we visualize this to make this more useful for ourselves? So I've got another quiz for you now. Here we go. Let me get the question in. This is going to be question four because it's the fourth question, okay? If it was the third question, I'd call it question three. And if it was like the fifth or sixth question, I'll call it question five or six. But it's the fourth question, so I'm calling it question four, okay? Very simple question, right? So here's my Nigel graph. For the Nigel scale, we got core, we got good, we got bad. Okay, what I'd like you to do, question four, is the game of planning poker. Anyone heard of planning poker? You can get these cards, these planning poker cards, where you estimate your work. You know, here we go. Look at this. Estimate your work with these cards. Very famous agile approach. Is that core? Is that good? Or is that bad? Please now vote in the quiz box, the chat box. Please vote now. Vote now. Tell me, is that core? Is it good or is it bad? Then the planning poker approach. Good, good, good. We're all interesting. Good, 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 good. Good or bad, depending. Thank you for that. Good, 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 good. And it's faded out. Okay, so did anyone say mostly good? Huh, I like that one. That's like a weather forecast, isn't it? Fading to mostly. Because this is quite interesting, actually. No one said core, I think. It's not core. Oh, someone just said core. Sorry, Derek. It literally is. The one thing it isn't is core. Right? There is no agile method out there that actually has this estimation technique as a fundamental part of it. Right? But it's a good practice. It's a very good practice for newer teams. It isn't actually a great practice for mature teams, right? What some people find with this game, if you've ever played it, you'll know. What people sometimes find is the structure of the game, the way you vote blind, you show your cards, you discuss, you re-vote. They find that method is actually quite heavy and quite intensive. And it's like stabilizers on a bike. It's quite useful to get the conversations going when you're in a new team, when you could have low trust, low collaboration, low communication. What they find, if you work together a few years, this thing can get a bit ritualized and get a bit in the way. I don't want to do that. And if you go online now, you will actually see people saying, do you know what? I've got friends who say it, in fact. They go, planning poker? That sucks. What a rubbish technique. What a silly technique. And you get some people going, no, you idiot. It's a great technique. It really helps. And then, no, it doesn't. It's a rubbish technique. Oh, you do rubbish. How can you? No, it's a brilliant technique. Yeah, well, what are you on about, mate? And what they're doing is they're just looking at the elephant from different sides. You've all heard that story, by the way, the famous, I think it's from India originally. The idea is these wise men are blindfolded and then they're taken to an elephant and they feel it and supposed to work out what it is. And I think one feels the tail and goes, well, it's obviously a rope. And one feels the ear and goes, it's obviously a fan. And one feels the trunk and he's like, oh, it's a snake. What are you on about? It's all the same elephant. It's just from different angles, right? It's the same thing here. So actually, it's not good or bad. Depends on your experience. Now, there are other estimating techniques out there. You may have heard of this one. If you haven't, just go look it up. There's loads of information on it online called magic estimation. It's how best to describe it in 30 seconds. You basically just place a scale on Nero or on the table, and you just move the cards on the scale. Right? Very quick, very dirty. Is it good with the new team? Hell no. It's often done in silence. So if it's done in silence, you end up with a new developer going. But in a mature team with skill, with understanding, knowing the problem space, it actually becomes quite a valid technique. So now we've got two options. We've got two options, you know. We could try out this planning poker technique or we could try this affinity technique. What's the most interesting thing for me in this picture? What do you think the most interesting thing for me in this picture is?
Bit where they're both bad?
Yeah, that could be it. Yeah. I think most interesting for me of this picture is actually... I don't know if I've got a slide for it, so I'll just draw it. That, right? Because what's happening there? Well, I've marked that red arrow. What's happening there?
It's the crossover between the two.
Yes, the crossover between the two. And I think that's interesting, because how do you crossover? I think, because one of those presentations I mentioned earlier on was about advanced agile. Right, because I'm one of the I don't know if you know, the Scrum Alliance do these advanced training courses, so the advanced Scrum, these like trying to push people's skill up to the next level, right? And when they first developed these courses, they gave them names like CSM2, like it's a sequel, Rocky 2, like, oh, it's, and I said, oh, come on, that's such a nerdy name. We need to give them a name that actually says something about them. We should call them advanced courses. Right. I then realized once they did that, what the hell does advanced mean? It's not really good saying advanced, but, and so I looked in the dictionary and it turns out there are 35 blooming ways to define advanced. That's quite a lot. But what I discovered was, for me, was really genuine advanced teams aren't advanced. They're not advanced, right? What they are is advancing. Right? So the idea is ing. Advancing, getting better rather than I have advanced or I have got better. I like that so much. I'm writing a book that is now going to be called Ing. Not ING, so it's not the Dutch company, but Ing. Because the idea of changing. And I think that's what interests me most. Not so much is this good or bad, but Ing, changing. What should we do in that scenario? You know, and if you want to, you can overthink this horribly. Okay? Because you're thinking about, you've got two techniques. How do I swap across? So as a coach, as a scrum master, I could say, okay, tomorrow we're doing that new technique, right? Tomorrow we're changing technique, okay? That's me telling the team. How do you think a team may feel about that? You can put it in the chat box if you don't want to speak up. But how do you think a team would feel if I just said a scrum master, right, we're changing estimation method for Monday?
You're not having a, you're just pushing it on them rather than giving them a chance to chat about it.
Yeah. Pushing it on them, how they feel about me pushing it.
It'd just say, we're not doing that.
Yeah, or worse still, is not actually saying no. My biggest, if you work in a large company, you'll know this, it's people don't say no. They say yes, but they then do it half-heartedly. It's called malicious compliance. It's like, all right, yeah, okay, you want it? Yeah, we'll do it that way. And so it ends up not working properly. And so as a coach, as a scrum master, as a leader, that's a really bad way of working. So maybe we could try and, I don't know, try both techniques in parallel, see what the team like, maybe hybridize. Some people actually sort of evolve them together, mix them together, right? You know, there's all different ways of approaching this, okay? What I just think is we don't have enough of those conversations. We just have conversations effectively with a snapshot. Hey, here is a thing, right? This thing is good, rather than understanding the thing in context, okay? Now, if you want, we can get really carried away with this, right? We can look at loads of different things. You ever heard of no estimates? Anyone ever heard of the no estimates movement? Very trendy at the moment in Agile. Can you guess what the no estimates movement is about? Hashtag no estimates. Can you guess what their basic philosophy is?
Just start the work.
Just do it.
Just do it. In fact, the joke is that there's no points on stories. It's actually not about not estimating. What the no estimates people do is they spend their time, rather than sizing work, just chopping work into similar sizes and then just count it. So they are still estimating, aren't they, really? We did three this time, we're going to do three next time. But the idea is spend the effort chopping rather than sizing. Oh my God, you should see the fuss people make about this online. There is genuinely a couple of sort of big names, not in Agile, just in technology, who that idea blows their minds. They literally go mad. They're like, this is ridiculous. This is insane. This is impossible. How could you possibly, you're going to sacrifice people's careers? And other people go, but we do it and it works. And again, it all depends on context. They're looking at it from a different angle, okay? So something like no estimates, I really like it, the idea of chopping stories. It's really lovely, but it does take a lot of effort to get there. So it takes a lot of effort to get the domain space correct, to get your product, be able to do it, training teams to do it, getting a business that understands it. There's a lot of things you've got to put in place to make it work, and then it works. But you can see again now, it's an option, but is it good or bad? It depends on the experience of the group, okay? Better than bad estimates. Anything's better than bad estimates. And now what? You could take this as deep as you want to take it. Like backlog refinement. I think if we saw earlier on, a lot of people mentioned backlog refinement as a good thing. Do you see that back in the thing about getting big stories into smaller stories? That's a good thing or a core thing. But how you do it, there's a huge amount of variation, okay? Breaking big items into small items. It's some people used to do it in one big meeting, right? And that sucked, by the way. 8 hours in a meeting room, you know, like, okay, let's break it down a bit small. It was just horrible, right? And so how can we do it? Some people do it in a big meeting. They have a big meeting every sprint to break big features into small ones, okay? That's every sprint. Who does that? Every sprint, they have a big meeting to break big stories into small ones. Anyone do that? It's reasonable, isn't it? Pretty reasonable. Now, just after a while, it gets tiring. It never gets bad, but it gets a bit meh after a while. One big meeting, again? And so what some people do is they break it up into multiple meetings. They have multiple meetings in the prior sprint, getting the backlog in a good shape. Anyone do this? yeah, it's a bit better, isn't it? A bit better. Here's the problem, right? You try to do that with a new team, right? It's okay, we're going to have 5 meetings every sprint. They'll be like, more meetings? Someone said, what about as needed? Yeah, JIT refinement, they call it, just-in-time refinement, i.e. breaking backlog items down as and when you need it. Awesome. Try it with a brand new team. Okay, team, when you need to, break down some backlog items with the product owner. And at the end of the sprint, say, team, how'd it go? How did what go? The backlog refinement. Oh, I never got a chance to do any. Did you do any, Bob? I never got a chance. Dave, you and I? No, I didn't. Sandra, what about Sandra? Did you get a chance? What? Refinement. No. Okay. I don't think any of us did it. It's like, oh, Jesus. And so, again, legitimate, really powerful, really good. But you may have to sort of work your way towards it. And I think if we understand that, if we sort of, as agile people, appreciate that this is a journey, appreciate that context is key and things evolve whilst we're doing it, it makes this thing far more nuanced, less sort of religious, makes this thing far more useful, but also it makes it richer as an experience. So it's not just imposing what other people have done on top of you, okay? Now, this is where Nigel gets a bit carried away. Because then I start thinking about, okay, how do we do these swaps? And then I start thinking about how, as a coach, would I do these swaps? Hold that thought. I don't want to dig too much into that here. But I think it's interesting to think about, okay, what's the best way to introduce this idea? What's the best way for me to support my team through these ideas? Will the team find these ideas out for themselves? Because to be honest, I've worked as a coach in companies and they've been doing like that just-in-time refinement, like doing it as and when they need. And I said, oh, that's brilliant. When did you choose to do that? And they say, do what? You know, just-in-time, breaking down stories as and when you need to. They go, Dave, when did we decide to do it that way? I don't remember. Did we decide? Sue, did we decide? Is that wrong? Should we change it back? No, don't change it back. Don't change it back. But like, sometimes people just evolve their processes themselves. And as a leader, as a manager, as an agile person, that's brilliant. I'm not having to do anything at all. They're discovering their own ways through it, right? Which is really powerful as well, okay? Okay, yeah. Who will decide when we need these meetings, Scrum Master or team? There's no right answer to that, by the way, but I think that's an incredibly important question. Because as a facilitator, as a coach, if I push any idea, it's going to be far less well received than if a team pull the idea. So as a Scrum Master, I think I would love it if the teams could develop these ideas up themselves rather than me push them on. Of course, that's a lot slower and harder and more sophisticated than just saying, hey, I've been on a training course with this guy called Nigel. He said we should do it like X. Why don't we do it like X? Which is a far easier emotionally approach to take, right? Oh, we'll come back to PO in a second. Okay, so where are we going here? What's this one? Yeah, I've done that one. Let's move forward for that one. Okay, here's one, Scrum Masters. So Scrum Masters in general, in theory, they are absolutely core part of Scrum. But in many organizations, they treat them like they are part-time, or they treat them like they are unneeded, or treated like they would fade over time. Has anyone heard that in their companies? Well, the Scrum Master gets you going, but as a fully organizing Scrum team, you won't need one in the future. You know, why do you need someone to have a daily Scrum? That's a good point, by the way. If after 3 years, you still need someone to go, daily Scrum time, something's gone horribly wrong. It's like, another one today? We had one yesterday. So, yeah. But what you'll probably find in real life, actually, Scrum Masters grow into their roles. What I mean is most of us who have started as Scrum Masters started out a little bit incompetent. I'm so sorry. We didn't quite know what we were doing. We tried our best. But what you discover, Scrum Master, as they start growing in the role, they start actually realizing it isn't about the team. It's about the environment around the team, right? No matter how, you can't pull a plant up. A plant has to grow in the right soil. And so it's about getting that soil in place, like the organization surrounding it, the ecosystem surrounding it, the business surrounding it. My job as a Scrum Master is to work with them to build the right environment, like a gardener, to allow the flower that is the product and the flower that is the team to grow. Okay. And that's a lot more effort than just going, hey, So retrospectives, the process becomes easy. The process becomes part of the team. But that looking after, getting rid of the weeds, that is something that good Scrum Masters really grow into. Okay, and you may find that a far bigger job than perhaps people first realize, especially if you're in a big company. I know a lot of people Galway based, but there's like an American headquarters. You know, that's a big garden with lots of weeds in it that needs some work. Okay. Now, someone said about product owners. I think product owners are interesting, right? Because again, there's this theory out there that perhaps product owners should disappear over time as well. Ron Jeffries is one of a friend of mine, 80 years old, Ron is. If you ever post about Agile online, especially on Twitter, there's a good chance Ron will find you because he's retired now. So all Ron does every day is complain on the internet in a nice way. So Ron's like Jaws, dun-dun, dun-dun. Ron will find your conversation online. Now, Ron has been having these thoughts about maybe if we turned Agile up to 12, if the future of Agile was like turned to the maximum, we wouldn't need a product owner. The team would have domain knowledge, okay? The team would all know how to do the work. And I love the idea in theory, but in practice, that isn't actually what happens, right? Because again, depends on your problem space. Like how I've worked on products being built for lawyers. And no matter how much the dev team pretended they knew about law, and we did know a little bit about law, we're not lawyers, right? And so domain knowledge on Scrum teams is brilliant. But what we often find in real life with product owners is they grow into their role more, again, a bit more effectively than Scrum Masters, because they realize the focus of their work, the focus of the Scrum team, isn't producing more things, it's creating more value. Which is a really interesting conversation for a product owner. I don't just want more widgets. I want like more valuable things that I can actually generate for money and start working outside the team, start working outside in the organization. Again, look at your product owners now. Would you say your product owners are CEO of your product? Who would say their product owner is CEO of their product? They own it, they can control it, they can steer it. Who would say their product owners are a bit more product facilitators? Someone who doesn't really own it, but they know people, they talk to people, they try and sort of schmooze them through. Has anyone got any owned product owners? These are people who are just basically servants. They can't make any decisions. They're just literally like, you will build this. Yes, master. You know, anyone got that? Like the product owned, as I like to call them. It's a horrible anti-pattern out there. But at least if you've got a product owner, even a bad one's better than none at all. So you can build them up. You can build them up, right? Okay. Oh, God. This again, how nerdy do you want to go? It's like sprint backlog items. I get asked a lot as a coach questions with no answers. Like, how much should we decompose our work? We've got a thing. We've been given an object by the business. Ta-da! We need to build this. How much should we break it down? Like there's a universal answer. Hopefully you've realized by now there's no universal answer. You can break it down or as much as little as you like. What I would say, just when I started scrumming, it was compulsory to break down your work. Okay, Scrum said you must break down your work into engineering tasks. They must be in hours. Why did Scrum say that? Like 10 years ago, why did Scrum say that? You must break it down. You don't fancy a guess why Scrum said it?
Before that, everything was massive.
Yeah, stories were overly large. Stories were huge, right? So people broke them down. Here's another thing. How many long-term Scrum teams were there in the world in 2007, let's say? We started in 2003. So how many long-term Scrum teams were there in 2003?
Not a lot.
Here's the problem, right? So a little bit about Scrum. So Scrum was developed in Easel by, it's famously said by Jeff Sutherland. No, he was the CTO of Easel. The teams evolved their own practices in Easel, right? And Jeff Sutherland looked at it and said, that's good. In an American company, right? And then he said, this is really good. And he got his friend, Ken Schwaber, I said, Ken, you're a management consultant. Could you watch what they do and write it down? because it's like really cool. I'd love to know what it is, right? So we can do it again, so we don't forget it. So Ken went around writing down what everyone did. And Ken's famous gift to the world of Agile was he said, Jeff, these things are really good. We've written down. You could sell these, perhaps, in training courses for money. And then that's what Ken started out and did, right? But here's the problem. Ken looked at what these teams were doing, and that is good, and sold it, right? The problem was, when I started scrumming, all sprints were 30 days long. They were. You could have any length sprint you liked, as long as it was 30 days. Why was it 30 days? Because that's how long they were at Easel. Why were they a month long in the company Easel? I'll tell you why. I discovered this in a pub talking to one of the first members. It was basically their product owner came in every month. Jeff McKenna was like their coach stroke product owner, and he visited every month to have a look to see what they were doing. And that's why they were a month long. So remember I said right at the start, confusing good practice with a core practice is a bad practice, okay? And this is what happened, even right at the start of Scrum. When Scrum started, it was quite thick because Ken put everything in there he saw, core and good. And over the years, Scrum has thinned down, right? Over the years, Scrum has got thinner as people have realized that's a good thing, but it isn't an essential thing, is it? And they've taken out, chucked it out, basically. So imagine that things have been chucked out of Scrum. What's that got to do with this here, sprint planning? Basically, it's the same story in sprint planning. as you learn more, you need less detail, basically. So what you find is in Scrum teams, as they get more mature, they need to break down their stories less. And as they get more mature, not breaking down stories becomes a valid idea. Just like Scrum thinned over time, so the amount of process you have in your Scrum teams thins over time. That's why I always get very nervous, because some companies see things like this, right? And they see a successful business do this and they go, aha, I like that successful business. I want to be a successful business. That successful business is cool. Give me some cool companies. Name some cool companies for me in the chat box now. Let's have some cool company names. Come on, some really cool, famous companies. We want to be like them. Who do you want? Amazon. It's always Amazon at the moment, isn't it? Amazon, Netflix, Google, Apple. Oh, yes, right. Yeah. All great names. Oh, I want to be like them. Spotify. Yes, Spotify. Hey, I've downloaded a presentation about Spotify. It looks really good. We should copy it. No, because what you're doing is just copying the snapshot at the end. You're not copying the journey that was gone on. Okay. And so this is why I think we need to appreciate journeys and transition and evolution, because you may want to get to the same point they get to, but you may have to take steps to get there. It's an evolution. It's ing, not ed, right? And again, if you want to completely blow your minds, we can have some really weird conversations like this, where, okay, some people don't estimate their backlog, their sprints, or they don't estimate the internal content, the tasks. They may break down the stories, but they may not estimate, or vice versa. The reason I've got this here is there's this really weird orange line at the bottom, story point estimation. So, you know, stories. Stories are, you know, the what, right? And some people estimate them in story points. Yes. Now, some people, when they break it up into engineering work, they use story points on the engineering work. That isn't a good idea, by the way, generally, because they're called story points for a reason. They're about the stories. They're like an abstract unit at a high level. They're not designed for low-level work, right? So bad idea. But they could become a good idea depending on what's going on. Do you remember earlier on we spoke about changing again? It's quite interesting. Like, estimating your tasks in story points is for a new team, it's bad. For an old team, it's bad. For most of us, it's bad, right? But there's definitely a small time when it becomes a valid technique for people to use an abstraction on their low-level estimates as a crutch to swap into not estimating that low-level work anymore. And again, this is something that's not talked about enough in the Agile world. We talk about good and bad, but what about those practices that are like mayflies? You know mayflies? Well, they live for a day, don't they, or something? Maybe a bit longer. Mosquitoes don't live very long. It's a very short life cycle on that thing. But maybe for that short time, that practice can live and work, it could be a useful practice. And I think, again, we don't often think in it like that. We may think, okay, that practice is bad, thus we shouldn't do it. When in fact, it could be valid for periods of time, and we use it to help transition between approaches. Again, a conversation that not enough people are having in the Agile space. And so this is where I think it's all going. The evolution of Agile is into far more of this type of conversation, in transitioning, understanding, changing, and far less about good, bad, demonization of end pictures. God, we could go on all day. I'm not going to go on all day. Let's stop. Oh, okay. Retrospectives. Who has retrospectives? Show of hands. Fundamental core thing in Agile, in Scrum, in all the Agile approaches, reflection, right? Absolutely fundamentally core part of what we do. So why do they always go wrong? Why are they always a bit crap? Tell me now. Chat box, tell me now. Why are they bad? Well, why do they often go bad? Why do they often decay and just fall apart and go a bit?
People like to complain.
People love to complain. It's very easy to have a moan, isn't it? Like, yeah. Oh, lockdown. Oh, I hate the lockdown. I do what it's like in Ireland, but in the UK, I haven't been out of the house in ages. I've got really fat. It's horrible. Zoom calls. Kids are at home, no schools. Oh, God, right? Some people don't like to complain. Some people just stay silent in the back of the room. Sometimes you're repeating the same mistakes. Nothing ever gets done. This is a big issue, right? Because retrospectives age like milk, right? They as a technique, they're very powerful, but they've got a very short life cycle. So very quickly they decay, the novelty wears off and they become dry. Okay, so, oh, damn it, like, what do I need to do? Well, a good technique is actually keep changing your retro. And I don't mean change the branding of it. What I don't mean is, okay, everyone, we're having a retrospective. What went well? What didn't go so well? Everyone, I'm changing the retrospective. Now it's about what made you happy, what made you sad. Same thing, really. What I mean is actually fundamentally changing how we do it, okay? To get different insight, to get different revelation, to make it interesting and engaging and approaching the problem from a different angle. That's what good facilitators, good coaches, good scrum masters do. Good leaders, good managers do this. Change the method, keep it interesting and engaging. Use the novelty to get people engaged, right? Now that pattern is not part of Scrum, is it? Right? Scrum just says every sprint, reflect. Agile says inspect and adapt, reflect and adjust your work. It doesn't say keep changing how you reflect. And again, I think the 21st century Agile is going to be what I call, and wait for a nerdy term, meta patterns. What I mean by that is patterns of patterns. So the retrospective is a pattern of behavior that's quite good. Changing it a lot is a meta pattern, a pattern on that pattern. And I think, again, in terms of evolution of method and approach, having an understanding of shapes like that is crucial. But don't believe me, there's a wealth of literature out there on this. There's a website, if you're interested, called Scrum Plop. Don't judge the name, right? I mocked the name Scrum Plop years ago, and I got told off for it. I was sniggering like a child. Oh, it's called Plop. And they said, no, Nigel, it's very serious. But the Scrum Plop website is effectively a collection of patterns of successful behavior that may work for you in your organizations. I don't think that type of work is published enough. You get sort of like the fundamentals, but you don't get that sort of rich shapes that could help your products get better. I think it's scrumplop.org, but you have to look that up. I have got a book here for you. One sec. If you don't want to go to the website, but you want to spend money, there is this book called A Scrum Book. Okay. Now, by Jeff Sutherland, James Kipling. Now this book, interesting, massively thick, by the way. Some of it is a bit silly. Like, they've tried to claim that product backlog is a pattern. It isn't. It's an example of a pre-existing pattern. But in here are some really good shapes that you can use in your Scrum teams and your Agile organizations to make them slightly more effective, right? That's an interesting question. So, okay, company leaders often want to know how much something will cost to determine whether it's worth investing in initiative A or B. Yes. Is there anything in Agile that enables team to do this well? Ha. Well, okay. Multiple teams all estimating in different ways. How do you understand what can be delivered? Is this even possible in your view? Yes, very interesting. It is possible. There's a range of Agile estimation approaches out there. We've covered a couple in the course. There's many more. What I would say is be careful, because in complex work, estimates are frequently wrong because of the many dimensions that are not taken into account when you're estimating, okay? So what I would say, I estimate myself, I do that. It gives me a high level indicator. I also treat the estimate with utter contempt. So I know it's an educated guess. And I know it's going to change. Like, for instance, this building was built with Scrum. I don't know if you told you this, but it was renovated with Scrum, this barn I'm in at the moment, all because of COVID, right? But I had to run it as a Scrum project because I had a certain amount of budget to do the work. And I also knew that even though I trust my builders and we have a great rapport, I knew, you know, things change. And so actually what I had to actually do was have other levers to ensure I got the value I needed. So I used scope as a factor of control. So that's what a lot of people would do in that example. They would estimate, they would be ruthless with their prioritization, ruthless with their estimation, and be ruthless with their scope to try and steer the product in to make value come out. Because remember, in the end, it doesn't matter about being cheap. It manages about delivering value. Like, you could save 10 grand and half the value. That wouldn't be a sensible thing to do. So what I would also make sure is they start tracking return on investment, not just investment. You know, you can't save yourself to success. So that's what I would try and do in terms of Donald's point there. Question for you all, right? Should the product owner be part of the sprint retrospective? Should product owner, you've got a two-choice answer here, yes or no. Should they be part of a sprint retrospective? Let's have a look now. Let's see the answers now. Yes, yes, yes. Hell yes, 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 yes. Okay. So, yeah, basically, that's the official answer, isn't it? Yes, they should be part of the retrospective. If they're not part of the retrospective, you are doing things bad. Okay, wrong. You naughty people. Why is my answer this? Trust doesn't come instantly. Trust, respect, safety, these things all need to be built up. They all need to be evolved over time. Imagine you have a new product owner who joins your team. I am your new product owner. I have been brought in to find new ways to motivate you. Right. Okay, so that team, the team wouldn't say anything in front of that product owner. They would, everything's fine. It's all fine here. There are no problems. Okay, now you may be thinking, our product owners are not like that. I am a product owner. I'm not like that. No, you don't think you're like that. Just remember that. You may think you're happy-go-lucky. Hey, everyone, I'm your new product owner. Great to be working with you. Yeah, I've been brought in just to try and find some new ways to sort of find value in the current delivery. And, you know, maybe some new ways of slicing this work up. Just because you say it like that doesn't mean the team hear it like that. I'm going to find new ways to slice things up. I'm going to find new ways to slice. And so what I often find is sometimes we have to be suboptimal to get to optimal. Like, I often find that actually, is product owner outside the retro good? No, it's bad, right? But it may be least bad than having a bad product owner traipsing through a retrospective, not knowing what they're doing. And so think about the journey, think about the evolution to get somewhere. Keep your eye on the prize and understand you're inspecting and adapting. This isn't perfection on day one. We keep looking to perfect. Oh God, there's more. Yeah, this I think is what interests me more actually, just to wrap it all up basically, is that not so much should they be in or should they be out, but what can I do to accelerate that relationship and what could easily happen to slow down that relationship? Here are the final questions from me for you in this course. What can we do to speed up that relationship? What can we do to accelerate it, to build that rapport between business and technology more? Give me some ideas in the chat box now. Choose now. Chat box now, please. Give me some ideas of ways we can accelerate this, ways we can bring them closer to us. Build that rapport, build that trust, build that relationship. Night out. Experiments, transparency. When you say transparency, could you expand on that? Icebreakers, maybe. Get to know each other a bit better. Have a pint. What's the problem with pints at the moment? Hi, everyone. This is Diet Coke, by the way. But you can see, like, building rapport may be harder in a remote setting than over a physical setting. We lose, I know we all have to be remote at the moment, but there's a lot there that isn't being taken into account, perhaps. Right? And what can we do to slow it down? What sort of things do organizations do to slow it down, to make that relationship less effective, to things to make it harder to build that rapport? What sort of things do we happen here? Hard deadlines from the start. Yeah, I could slow it down. What else could slow it down? Don't empower the PO, gosh, yeah. Physical separation, emotional separation. And again, that's the type of thing we should be talking about, right? That type of thing should be talking about. A PO not part of the team, feeling very dislocated, okay? Now, if you wanted to, let me just see where we are now. Oh, I'm going to jump this. I'm bored with this one. Let's get moving on. I want to show you some final things, right? Which is, just to wrap this all up, this is where my thinking has got to. So literally, we're driving down a road of Nigel's ideas over the last 10 years. You've now reached the point where there's a construction sign saying, road under construction. Here are some new ideas, just to wrap this up, that have really not got been developed very far. Have you heard of Shuhari before? Anyone heard of Shuhari? Shuhari is like a martial arts idea that's been stolen in Agile very quickly. It's basically, Shu is you follow the martial arts slavishly. You may not fully understand it, but you do it. Have you ever seen The Karate Kid? Wax on, wax off, Shu. Ha is your black belt. You are, you know the art. You understand the art in all its ways. Ri is you have transcended the martial arts. Ri, you're Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee is a martial art, and the martial art is Bruce Lee. He's become the martial art. The line between method and human has been completely blurred, right? Well, we've been talking all the way through about evolving teams. What about organizations? Because my concern is that basically, depending on your organization, may depend on how these practices work or don't work in your organization. Now, this is not an excuse to do bad stuff, but what we're finding is in organizations that are a bit more shoo, that there seems to be like a gravity on practices, like pulling core practices to make them more optional, or maybe pulling bad practices up into good practice. So this pressure to malform or accept abuse in organizations that don't fully understand this. Maybe it's not a mark, maybe it's gravity, like a organizational historical gravity affecting how you do things. But I think that's important to appreciate. I think the organizations where, like you said, Amazon, like all these famous Google, there's none of that gravity. People can do things and try things in a much safer space. The gravity is a lot lower. It's like jumping high on the moon. Yet where you are, there may be a heavy gravity where it's difficult to get these processes working. And that doesn't mean, oh, my organization's new to Agile, thus we'll do it badly. that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying, it'll be harder to do the things you need to do well. And there'll be more pressure on those practices to decay quicker or be harder to use. So I can't remember your name, sorry, but who mentioned about estimating work earlier on? Things like story points and team-based estimation can be used for that. But if the organization doesn't understand any of that, that's going to put a huge pressure and pain on those estimates and make them even less valid. Okay, let's blow your mind to the last 2 minutes. Let's ignore that. Oh, yeah, okay. So, Kinevin, if you want to just really go mad, look up Kinevin. Can I get a quick show of hands? Who's heard of Kinevin or Cinefin, as it's pronounced? If you haven't heard of Kinevin, it's some complexity science of all things. And the complexity scientists have come up with this very simple model. Dave Snowden's come up with it, saying there are different types of problem. And depending on your type of problem, depends on how it affects how you work. He called it clear, complicated, complex, chaotic, and confused. I'm not going to get into this now because we're running out of time, but what I would say is your problem space will have a fundamental effect on the approaches you use. Who here used to be like a traditional project manager? Or maybe you still are. It's okay. Admit it now. It's like Alcoholics Anonymous. I swear I used to be. Like, it's been 10 years since my last Gantt chart. But the fact is that that wasn't actually wrong. It was not wrong. What we did, how we worked was not wrong. It just may have been wrong for the problem space we were trying to apply it to. So things like traditional planning, upfront Gantt charts, these are all like clear planning techniques that work very effective in that problem space. But if you apply them in a complex problem space, they don't work. And so depending on your problem space depends on if a practice is good or bad. Oh, Jesus, now things are getting annoying, aren't they? And if you really want to wind yourself up, there is Kent Beck's work on what he calls explore, expand, extract. So this is, explore is when you're like a startup. You're trying to find your fit, trying to find your model, your market. Expand is when, okay, we found it. We found the model. Now we need to scale, okay? We need to add scaling. And then extract is mining, pulling in from exploiting, pulling value out. Do you remember we spoke about the Scrum Alliance earlier on? When I was involved with them, they were still a bit in explore and they were moving to expand. So they have found certified Scrum, they have found the market, they have found the shape of the product, and now they're trying to add volume to it, trying to add trainers to get more people training it, right? Expand, right? What you may find is the techniques you use will vary in success or failure depending on the type of opportunity you have. So, okay, quick show of hands. Not show of hands, in chat box, one last time. Who thinks their product they're working on is explore? Discovery and new and all starty-uppy and trying to, may not be a startup, but that sort of thing, trying to find the right ideas. Who's explore? Type now if you're explore. Give me an explore if you're in the chat box. If you feel you're in expand, you're like scaling, you're adding value, you're removing bottlenecks, you're trying to grow yourself like the Scrum Alliance was with its trainers, please put expand. And if you feel you're a bit of a miner, you're down the mine, there's an old mine you're working the ore out of, the copper out of. Who feels they're a bit more extract? I see the extractors out there. I just think it's interesting, again, because I feel, especially some of the techniques out there, some of them seem to me to be a bit more extract than anything else. They're ways of sort of mining information out of a pre-existing scene, which may not be as appropriate for an expand or explore states. Okay. Where am I on this stuff? Again, this is right where the end of the road now. Could the method and the context affect how you engage with a team as a facilitator, as a coach, as a leader? So again, this is a whole hour in just 10 seconds, but these five things are what we call coaching stances. Three of them I've stolen from the world of teaching. Two of them I've added, but they're all stances a coach could take in work. Consult is tell. That's what I'm doing now. I am telling you things, you are listening. Collaborators, hey, let's work together on this. Colleagues together. Coaches, therapist. So why do you feel about your mother that way? Character is showing the right behavior, role modeling, just doing the right thing the right way. And silence, by the way, I should call it consciously silent, but I was trying to get all C's. Silence is shh. Sometimes you just keep your mouth shut. Okay? I think depending on organizational culture, problem space, opportunity, all these things, it's team skill, all these things feed into how I should or could engage with a team as a facilitator, as a change agent, as a leader, as a manager. Okay, I've done no more work on that. So if you're expecting me to have some nice drawings on these, I have not got there yet. I'm still working on those ideas. But I think having that conversation would be really interesting in a modern, evolving, agile organization. How do you like being engaged with by a facilitator? Like for me, I'll tell you now, I hate, and it sounds awful. I'm an agile coach. I've been an agile coach 15 years, 16 years. I hate being coached. Hate it. Hate being coached. Can't stand it. I just want to be shown how to do it. Just show, just act the right way and I'll pick it up. You know, I will learn from you, but don't sit me down and sort of go, okay, what made you think that? Don't, that I hate that sort of therapy paternal type coaching model. And I think, just talk to me as an adult, work with me on this. Just let's be friends on this. And I will give so much more. I'll do so much better. That's my preferred stances. Okay. You may have your own preferred stances, but I think having some conversation around that would be absolutely fascinating. I've got to be getting near the end now. Oh yeah, if you thought, you know what, I want some more Nigel for some reason, I just want to learn more about this. I have used this Nigel scale and applied it to scaling frameworks like SAFe, LESS, Scrum at Scale, all these famous scaling frameworks. I've tried to sort of use that, not that core good bad model, and look at them and try and work out where there are issues and concerns. I know a lot of people are doing SAFe at the moment, Scaled Agile Framework. I think it's worth having a watch of that video and having a discussion about it, because I think you can make it work, but there were some concerns about that. There's a new version of Scrum that came out recently. They update it every couple of years. If you want to see how what I think about that and how the Nigel scale works on that, here's another video you can go watch on YouTube called Scrum Update, where we talk about that new, how Scrum evolves over time. What I would say is there's been a couple of changes in Scrum recently. They've added some things to it and taken some things out. That may be an interesting conversation to have. Scrum keeps evolving. It isn't the same thing as it was 20 years ago. The agile movement keeps moving. And to wrap this all up, it's even happening in other things like Kanban. Have anyone done Kanban or doing a Kanban approach? Even the Kanbaners are kind of going, okay, this is getting a bit heavy now. We need to start slimming back on what we say is core and what is just good stuff to do. So I'm not claiming credit for that. Dan barely knows who I am, but I think other movements in Agile are having similar conversations about, hang on a minute, what's actually really key here and what is just nice and what will differentiate between the two, okay? Final caveat, right? In this entire thing, I have taken time to be linked to experience and experience to be linked to learning. That's a big assumption. I retired at football a couple of years ago. I was 40 years old and I was crap at football, right? It's not because I was 40, because I was crap at football at 30, crap at football at 20, crap at football at 10, crap at football when I started playing it at 6. I'm crap at football. I've had coaching, I've had training, I've played a lot of football over the years. I'm crap at football. So just understand, I'm making an assumption with some of these graphs that teams will learn. If your teams aren't learning, what they say, some people have the same year's experience every year, right? And you must have seen it. So you go on Facebook or Instagram, and someone you know has had a wonderful holiday somewhere. And you just know the location's marvelous, but they didn't get much out of it, did they? Because in the end, it's, you know, like a dull person in an exciting location doesn't equal an exciting person. Just equals a dull person in an exciting location. And so just be careful of that a little bit, okay? There were some more things, but I'm not sure I can bother to show them to you. They're really not that interesting. You don't want this. That's all boring. I'm going to jump past that. This is interesting. I just think you'll find that my hope for the future of Agile, the next 20 years, is some of these core ideas will keep slimming. So the fundamentals get quite tight and slim. And then we all start discussing the sandwich filling a bit more. Right, I think in Agile still there's a bit too much wobble on these like core fundamentals. People are going, do we really need to plan or not plan? You know, there should be, I hope in the next 20 years there'll be a more of a common agreement on some of those fundamentals, and then we can get into the contextual ing stuff. I think that'd be far more interesting, wouldn't you? But hey, hope that's my hope for the next 20 years. And I think with that in mind, I'm done. I have no idea how long this is supposed to last. I've probably overrun my box horribly, but that's fine. If any conversations or questions, feel free to hang around with me and we can have a chat about it. Dee or someone wanted to mention something, but I can't remember what it was. What was it, Dee?
It's the workshop, Nigel, on the 12th of March.
Yes. There's a workshop on the 12th of March.
Nigel.
With me, it's on remote tools, like trying to just work out how to do this stuff. Yeah, collaboration tools online, basically. If you're interested, that's available. But if you want to escape, feel free. You can follow me on any of the social media platforms I've got listed on the screen. If you want to have a chat about anything, feel free to hang around afterwards. We can talk as long as you want about whatever you want. This is my hobby as well as my job. But if you don't want to, feel free to escape offline. When will the recording be available? I don't know, Andy, but if you want, there is actually a article on all this. I've actually turned this into a 12,500 word article, which is on my blog, which you type in Nigel Baker Agile blog. You should find it on Google somewhere, where I've basically blogged all this. So all of that content's out there, written down, if you want to go and peruse it at a slightly slower speed. And maybe...